On the 28th of May, the MAPS LED open panel discussion was held at the Mediterranea University of Reggio Calabria. The event was meant to kick off the research activities of the MAPS LED research project. This is a project funded by Horizon 2020, and it is led by Professor Carmelina Bevilacqua, the director of the CLUDs Laboratory of the University of Reggio Calabria. Several worldwide acknowledged scholars gathered for the panel discussion, which was opened by Professor Marcello Zimboni on behalf of the General Administrator of the University. Later, the Vice Mayor of the City of Reggio Calabria, Dr. Saverio Angeloni, welcomed the event, stating that he hoped the gathering would result in a more efficient use of funds from Europe allocated to the territory. Also, Tommaso Calabro, representative of the Calabria region, remarked on the importance of the EU S3 platform for development and the role of research and innovation in spurring economic development. Finally, Professor Ferrara stressed the importance of higher education institutions as a driver of the creation of startups and new businesses.
This event is to kick off the research activities within the research project MAPS-LED, which is funded through Horizon 2020, and more specifically, through a defined action which calls for empowering and consolidating research networks based on research projects aiming at the knowledge transfer. That's why we work as a team, which is composed of 4 European universities and 2 US American ones, aiming at the knowledge transfer, which is an objective of Horizon 2020. In particular, the research project is focused on the smart specialization strategy. These strategies represent an approach which have reformed the cohesion policy. Personally, I consider the entire strategy, Europe 2020, as an approach to the regional development, at the same time a way to program and to embody the objective to create the knowledge-based economy according to specific context. So, the innovation lies not in the context, rather in approaches, processes activated to understand the context where the cohesion policy has been implemented. Thus, the cohesion policy is a European policy aiming at the economic development. Our project deals with a problem concerning the spatial territorial aspects related to that strategy, to the new role of research and innovation introduced not just along the production process, but in all the aspects of the society and so to the territory, to the territorial layouts, the city, the urban systems, and their hierarchies. Our research seeks to highlight the spatial factors which might interact within this conceptual framework to discover new specialization demands oriented to the creation of growth according to the knowledge-based economy. I am glad to remember that this is the 40th year of the existence of European structural funds. Thanks to these research projects led by the network composed of the US, American, and European universities, the CLUDs Laboratory belonging to the University from Reggio Calabria embodies this general approach to deal with those topics which represent a connection between the territory and the economy, or the economic development. We adopt this approach to find a link between the European policy for research and the cohesion policy. They look like as two drivers, which just formally aim to meet each other. However, in practice, that who works with research projects within different programs does not know what the cohesion policy is, how the cohesion policy works, how to translate the results of research activities into inputs, nor synergies, with those who are in charge of managing the regional policy, and so shapes the cohesion policy at regional level. For this reason, we manage the international doctorate, which is funded through PORFSE, through the Calabria region, linked to a research project funded within the 7th framework program created. Now, we want to foster it through the education of those students in order to, as the professor Ferrara said before, create an environment suitable to innovation and to the creation of regional territorial development.
This is going to be quite a challenge. I have the job of trying to put together the pieces. You are looking at some of the greatest minds in Europe on the topic we are addressing, and I mean it as a humble observer and practitioner in the field. And it's a very composite puzzle that we are going to try to put together, because there are, as you could sort of see from Carmelina's introduction, there are some somewhat contradictory pieces that we're talking about here. We're talking about cohesion policy, which is aiming to help poorer regions catch up, which is aiming at social cohesion, which is aiming at a fairer world for everybody. We're talking about research and development policy, which is normally looking at harder stuff, industrial interests, research and development, et cetera, et cetera. And we're also talking about territory, about spatial policy, which is talking about the organization of spaces. And the word territory, since we're in a European context here, you have to keep in mind the word territory can mean quite different things to different people. In Italy, the word territory refers to the substance of a place, all of the capital, the culture, it derives from the Italy of the delle cento città, where the territory is directly tied to its cultural heritage, its history, and so on and so forth. In France, in French, the word territoire means a local authority, and that's about it. In other areas, like in the United States, territory tends to refer to the area that someone has a jurisdiction over. Dogs mark their territory. You fight over territory. So we're talking about, and that's another part of the puzzle that we need to try to, that we want to try to put together, maybe not integrate, but at least see where the pieces sit and how they fit. We don't necessarily need to arrive at a composite picture, okay? Now we are going to do that first with some presentations. Our first speaker is the father, we could say, of smart specialization, which is, in my opinion, if I can say, a first attempt to sort of break the impasse, and that something wasn't working. In the structural funds, which are meant for social cohesion, in the 2006-2013 period, 271 separate regions were spending a total of 86 billion euro on research and innovation, and there wasn't any coherence to all of that. That was more than the European Research Fund. So the research was actually happening all over the place in the different regions in ways that didn't even have a whole lot to do with the cohesion policy that they were in. So obviously Mr. Foray will have the word, but the attempt to break this impasse was to turn the policy making process into a process, to open up the policy making process, to rethink what is the role of innovation, what role can innovation play, not only to invent iPads and iPhones, but also to reinvent our territory and reinvent our prospects and the kind of things that we can live with. And what grew out of first, I think you were part of a high-level expert group on as an economist at the University of Lausanne. What grew out of a first series of papers and a first general concept, I would say Professor Foray has also had the courage to follow through from academic papers, to follow through with the commission, which is not an easy task, to actual implementation. And this is actually happening around Europe. It's actually happening in 271 regions in an imperfect way, but it's in many regions, including Sicily, where I am working, it's having an enormous impact, and it's already changing the way people are doing things. So let's hear from the guy who got it all started, if we could say, and he will say that's not the truth, and see what your view is on how is it working. 15 minutes you've got. I'll signal your time as you go along.
Thank you, Jace. I'm not from the University of Lausanne. I'm from the Ecole Polytechnique.
Yes,
EPFL, which is just a little change. Thanks to Professor Bevilacqua for having invited me here. I'm very pleased to be here and to contribute to this discussion about smart specialization and to try to think a little bit more about the relationships between smart specialization and territory, local processes in particular. Smart specialization, this is about innovation, this is about research and development, this is about industrial policy in a sense, but the emphasis is strongly about local capabilities, how to build local systems of innovation, because one of the main issue of smart specialization, this is really to think that the territory is by itself an engine for innovation, and so how to realize the opportunities offered by the territory is a little bit the idea. Let me give you really a brief fundamentals of smart specialization. When we started to think of this, we were thinking that regional economies like Calabria, for example, they need structural changes, which means modernization of traditional sectors, diversification of the economy, and also probably the establishment of radically new activities or new industries. And there is one word to capture all these issues: modernization, diversification, establishment of new activities. This word, this is innovation. And so smart specialization, this is really an innovation policy, but not only, I wanted to say I'm very disappointed because, you know, 10 minutes ago, the students have designed a very nice technology to have a remote control with an iPhone, so this was very exciting, and now, you know, I'm with this very old type of technology, but maybe more reliable. So, innovation policy, which is not only horizontal, which means, you know, we had this dominance of this kind of policy for the last two decades, which were, we can say, sector neutral, emphasizing framework conditions, you know, trying to help any actors which are facing the kind of similar problems, like human capital, finance, and infrastructures, and so on and so forth. Of course, horizontal policy, this is good, good policy, because it helps the whole system to progress, while it minimizes government failures, it minimizes distortions. But it is not enough. It is not enough, and in particular for less developed regions and for transition regions in Europe, we really observe that horizontal policy, so this kind of transversal actions to improve general conditions, They did not succeed in allowing these regions to reduce the knowledge gap, the knowledge difference between the top regions and the less advanced region. And when the knowledge gap has been somewhat reduced, for example, by investing in public sector research in particular, then this hardly transformed into real economic convergence. And so there is therefore a need to go beyond horizontal policy and to encourage regions to build capabilities in a few specific fields where the region thinks it can build competitive advantages. This is the idea, and where structural changes, so transformations, diversification can be driven. This is smart specialization. This is what we wrote in 2010, so when we advised the Commissioner Potocnik. So this is not a new word for just a good innovation policy. This is something different where really the idea is about specific construction of specific assets in particular sectors. Let me give you a graphical representation of that. Here we have this kind of horizontal policy. You see country regions have improved somewhat the knowledge infrastructure with horizontal instruments like incubators, like PhD programs, all these things that can improve the whole system. But so it worked in a certain way, but it did not translate into economic progress, and so we did not really get the famous spillovers, you know? And there is no such thing that a quasi-magical effect of knowledge, notably in the form of spillovers. And this means that we need different things. And for example, I just talked with the president of this university. It has been observed in many cases that in many regions, you know, regions are investing in PhD programs, you know, to have young engineers. But then they don't stay in the region. They go elsewhere, you know? And we call that the Midwest syndrome, because in the US, it has been the same in Texas and the other kind of, you know, states. In the middle of the US, they are investing a lot in terms of PhD programs, but then the people are go elsewhere. They go on the east or on the west. They don't stay in the region. And so in a sense, you know, it's not a loss of money, but actually the investments which have been made don't realize in terms of spillovers for the regional economic growth. So we need something different on the top of this horizontal policy, and here we are. This is three examples of smart specialization. The first one from Galicia in Spain. This is the development of biotech in fisheries. This is advanced manufacturing for the footwear industry in Portugal, in northern Portugal. And the final one is animal genetics for the breeding sector in Limousin, France. What do we have here? We have, in a sense, domains, new fields which are opened and explored through the connection and integration between different types of actors and different types of knowledge. And these new activities, for example, biotech in fisheries, this is not only about science and research, but this is really about the full ecosystem of innovation, which connects science, research, industry, services, lead users, etc. And in all these examples here, we see research and innovation activities which are complementing existing structures and assets in order to open and explore new opportunities. So we don't build cathedral in the desert here, like we have seen in the past. We really have this kind of knowledge-driven activities which are embedded in and complementing with the existing structures in order to transform these structures, to modernize fisheries, to drive a transition in the footwear industry, etc. And in such cases, this investment in the knowledge economy, they will translate into economic progress, because the goal is to transform the existing structures, and the other sectors are connected so that we can have diffusion of innovation. And so the goal of the policy here is really to concentrate resources, support the formation of local ecosystem, and provide the complementary resources that are specific to emerging activities. And I think that the very notion of innovation ecosystem needs to be specific, because different activities require different things. If we think of biotech in fisheries, if you know, we are in Galicia and we want to develop biotech applications to modernize fisheries, and to succeed in developing the application, to succeed in translating this application into tools for fisheries, and to succeed in making these tools adopted by the companies, we require a very specific ecosystem, which is very different from the one for advancing manufacturing technologies in the footwear industry. And so the local ecosystem is local in two senses, local in terms of the region and local in terms of specific capabilities for a specific activity. And so the policy here is not horizontal, as the policy before, or sector neutral. It has to deal with the specificities and the complexity of each activity, and the government commitment is necessary to allow these new activities to emerge and grow. But this has a cost. This has a cost, because this is more like haute couture than ready-to-wear, because if each of these emerging activities requires specific capabilities, specific assets, then, of course, it's very costly. And it's very different from a horizontal policy where, for example, you have an R&D tax credit. This is ready-to-wear. You can apply that to all. You know, it's very simple, no risky. Here, you need to think of what are the complementary capabilities that my ecosystem about fisheries and biotech needs, and that's really complicated. And so to finish with this beginning, so smart specialization has two phases. Building capabilities in specific domains, biotech in fisheries, or footwear industry and advanced manufacturing technologies, in order to change the system, to modernize fishery, to modernize the footwear industry, etc. Of course, in some cases, it is possible to have structural changes by importing all factors. You know, you think of tourism, which is, you know, an activity, a sector that many regions in Europe like. You can modernize your tourism sector just by outsourcing ICT application to a consulting company which is based in London, okay? This is fine, this might be a good sectoral policy, but this is not smart specialization. Because smart specialization, we are thinking about the value of building local capabilities to make this transformation. And so smart specialization is sometimes called a place-based policy approach, and I think it is good because it means that we think there is a value in building these local capabilities. In Galicia, we want to have modernizing fisheries with biotech application, which will be developed in Vigo, on the campus of the University of Vigo. This is the idea. And this will form a full ecosystem, which is, I think, very important because we believe that this is really the engine of innovation in a region, this co-location of research, companies, labor forces, etc. Of course, it doesn't mean that the region should be closed. I mean, smart specialization is open and always needs extra-regional resources, extra-regional knowledge that has to be mobilized towards different kind of mechanism. But of course, this building of local capabilities is really key. Now, 5 minutes, thank you, Jesus. The problem is that the regional government cannot address all problems of all emerging activities, and so we need to choose. And this is the key issue of smart specialization. We are doomed to choose. This is not because it is desirable to make choices between different kinds of activities. This is just inevitable. And then, of course, when a policy starts to choose, which is different from an horizontal policy where you apply your solution to everyone, if you have to choose, do I want biotech in fisheries to be supported, or do I want ICT in tourism? Do I prefer agro-food, modernization, etc.? When you do that, you can make a lot of mistakes. First mistake, the government thinks he knows everything, the omniscient planner, and he has this ex-ante knowledge about what to do. And think he doesn't need any information from the grassroots. This is the first mistake, and the temptation is big to buy consulting companies' services, which will produce a nice report in color with a lot of figures, a lot of graphs about the strengths, the weakness of a region, and then the government will decide what to do. And I think it is the wrong way. So this is the first mistake. Second mistake is to make choices at sectoral level, to say, okay, my smart specialization, this is tourism. This is not the good way, because for an innovation policy, tourism doesn't mean anything. So the choice has to be made at a finer grain level. For example, I want to support the activity of developing ICT for tourism. This is different of supporting just tourism. So this is the second mistake. And the third mistake, which is absolutely key, this is to think that the choice I'm making now, this is forever. Like with Ricardo, the economists know, Ricardo, you know, Portugal will make wine and UK textile forever. This is not the idea. The idea is to change during the operational phase of the program. New priorities will come because new opportunities will emerge, etc. And so to avoid such mistakes, we need a lot of a few design principles. I will be very short. Entrepreneurial discovery, this is the firm. This is the first principle, which means the government does not know ex ante what to do. They have not innate wisdom. After, even if they have made a lot of statistical representations of the regional economy, etc., and so they have to rely on the discovery process to give the words, the voice to companies, local universities, lead users. They all can say about, okay, this is here a domain where we are have the capacity to build competitive advantages. So the information has to come from the grassroots, and then the government will choose what kind of activities I want to support specifically according to a couple of criteria which are here. So this is the first thing, and it's very difficult for government, even regional government, to say, okay, I have not the knowledge. I have not the perfect knowledge. I need to listen and to interact with companies, with local universities. Local universities have a great role in entrepreneurial discovery. In many regions where companies are somewhat weak, the local university has really a role to help to structure this entrepreneurial discovery project. Then, as I said, no sectoral prioritization. So the problem is not to say, okay, I have a lot of example in France, the Région Centre, Château de la Loire, you know. They say, okay, tourism, this is my specialization. I say, no, it's not. It's not a smart specialization. But maybe you can improve your tourism efficiency with ICT application development in your region. That might be a smart specialization. And finally, so, this is a flexible, we talked of this, flexibility. This is a flexible strategy, which means that you have not to take your choices forever, and you will change. I mean, in the course of the process, it will be changed, it will be evolved, because new opportunities will come, and you will have to support them. To summarize, I'm almost finished. This is about putting in place a process which will allow to identify future domains of competitive advantages with this idea of entrepreneurial discovery, to concentrate resources on a few domains, fisheries and biotech, manufacturing technologies and footwear industry, breedings and genetic animals, etc., concentrating resources on that, helping these domains to grow, measuring progress, and restart the process, reset the process at any time. This is very important. So because maybe in 2 years, new ideas, new discoveries will happen and you have to support them. Let me give you a little example how it happens concretely. This is Portugal, northern Portugal, one of the three examples. So, and this has been a response to the competitive shock in the footwear industry, which has been produced by the Chinese companies, etc. This is the formation of an ecosystem, local ecosystem in the north of Portugal. So it started with the engineering school in Porto. This involves companies specialized in manufacturing tools and software development. This involves, of course, footwear companies, which were quite advanced in designs and models. This was supported by the regional innovation agency. And here you have the exploration of a new domain, to what extent advanced manufacturing technology can help the segment of this industry to progress, to advance, and the innovation agency supported that. And here we have all the good characteristics of a process of smart specialization. This is not sectoral specialization. This is specialization about one activity, advanced manufacturing technology in this industry. And you have very good results, actually. The segment of this industry in Portugal became a leader in Europe, which was not the case before. And the value of the local ecosystem here is clear, but we can talk on this later. After 2 years of implementation, I am quite optimistic, but we can go on that further. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You can see, for those of you who have not seen smart specialization, this is radical stuff. Imagine the different regional authorities throughout Europe. I think what is going on now is one of the biggest policy experimentations to happen in Europe. It's an enormous scale, and it's actually happening in a certain sense very fast, because the Commission actually had the courage to do this, or to at least try, and time is short, so it's happening fast, which is sometimes a good thing, because some people are making mistakes, it's being sloppy around the edges. But in a moment we will get to, in Italy, what has been the concrete experience of trying to do that with real people in real administrations that are trained to do practically the opposite, never experiments. But let's first try and get a deeper understanding, because what you have just seen touches on and brings together, as I was saying before, different aspects of regional policy planning that were thought to be at war with each other. The territorial dimension is there. The economic development cluster dimension is there. And a dimension of inclusion, of openness, of ownership is there. So let's take a deeper look at each of these three perspectives from, again, some of the top experts in these fields to get a better understanding of what are the dynamics that we're working on and how might they potentially come together. The first speaker, who is at war with the Macintosh at the moment, is Professor Andreas Faludi, who is sort of considered the father, if not the accompanying uncle, of the European spatial development perspective, the probably first and only time that Europe has tried to give a spatial design and strategy to all of the European territory, which has since become the territorial agenda. It's changed names, it's changed faces, but it is, if anything, the spatial perspective is represented by Mr. Faludi, who will tell us about it, I think, in the next 15 minutes. You are at Delft. He's been everywhere, Oxford, Vienna Institute of Technology. Won't go into the details. Let's hear what you have to say. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Can you hear me?
No, the button to the left, I think. You have to push it.
One, two, three, yes?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I am totally dependent on the screen, and you are totally dependent on the screen. So I have a real problem. I can't even read it myself. My presentations are always interactive. Yes, I interact with the screen. So I will try and make the best of it. Thank you very much. Yeah. But if you can't read it, I can at least read it here from the iPad. I'm going to talk about smart specialization strategies in relationship to territoriality, taking up a point that has been emphasized already in the program, that S3 strategy is necessarily place-based. And I'm going to look at this concept of place. But first of all, yes, I was introduced as a European. It means I was born in Hungary. I spent there the first 6 years of my life. I moved on to Austria. I grew up there speaking German and have an Austrian PhD. I then moved to the UK, and that's why I acquired my hopefully British accent. And then I went to the Netherlands, and I'm now a Dutch citizen. And from there, I watch what European spatial planning. I wrote a book on what's called the European Spatial Development Perspective together with a colleague, and this is supposed to be the cover of the book there. It's called The Making of the European Spatial Development Perspective. By the way, I advertise myself on the screen as a renegade spatial planner. I mean, I come from spatial planning. A spatial planner usually works for, on behalf of, or is commissioned by an authority. Spatial planning, because it uses instruments of land use planning and public investment, it's inherently related to what authorities do on whatever level, including the state. Actually, in the end, spatial planning relates to the jurisdiction of the state. That's what, where the concept of territory or territoriality comes in my presentation. I'm a renegade because I'm criticizing authorities, I'm criticizing jurisdictions. This has everything to do with another book that I wrote 5 years ago on the continuation of the ESTP process. It's called Cohesion, Coherence, Cooperation, European Spatial Planning in the Making, and it's about spatial planning, European spatial planning in relationship to cohesion policy. Next slide is about the concept of synergy, which is central to S3 and the notion of territoriality. The S3 strategy has a number of features which I have learned and which I'm sort of kind of aware of, but it's not my main subject. It's supposed to be effective, it's supposed to be integrated, it's supposed to emphasize the strong points, we heard that already, of a territory, but it's hard to translate into spatially oriented development policies. That's a difficult point there, because, and why? Well, that's what I was, I think I give up on that. I give up on that, yes? I mean, it's just illegible. Why is it hard to relate to space? Because space is dominated by authorities. I read something by a specialist on innovation policy, and she says there's a danger of myopic approaches confined to regional boundaries. That's the key point, confined to regional boundaries and overlooking potential cross-border synergies. I suppose, I think that this is a major issue in S3 policy, in innovation policy, and that takes me now to the concept of territoriality. I will first of all explain briefly the concept of territoriality. Secondly, I will, in the view of this, revisit the story of EU cohesion policy. And then I'm going to discuss territoriality in relationship to democracy, because the major strong point of territoriality is that it is based on representative democracy. And so what I put to you is that if you want to pursue a place-based approach, if you really want to do that, you are beginning to question, and Barca has started to question, representative democracy in the way in which you organize it. So that's potential dynamite. And I've come to some conclusions. Territoriality. There is a definition of territoriality which in the geographic literature is very common by an American, Robert Sack. It is the attempt to affect, influence, or control people, phenomena, and relationships by delimiting and asserting control over a geographic area. And this is basic, it's absolutely fundamental to the concept of the state. Ever since France has developed its own territory, the French kings have developed their own territory. The French kings were the first to map the territory. They were actually making use of an Italian cartographer family, a father and son, Cassini, to map the French territory, which was absolutely revolutionary. In the meantime, this is self-evident. And we have an image of the European Union now as a mosaic of 28 member states, almost contiguous. I mean, there's the whole of Switzerland in the middle, and there are some odd places, but it's a territory of territories, of jurisdictions. Now, I call this absolutistic territorialism. Why absolutistic? Because the powers of the state are absolute.
Why do you clock it?
I mean, the powers of the state over territory is meant to be absolute. The state is 100% responsible for its territory. Absolutistic territorialism. Smart specialization strategy and many other strategies are actually tending to reconstruct territories, create new territories, or create new spaces. And thereby, they undermine the question of territoriality. I don't think we can do with that.
Yes.
I'm not sure whether you can even see it, yes? I'm sorry about that, but that's not what I can do. So back to you, in place-based policies, you create new places. You create new territories, and you recreate them. They change. I call this relativistic constructivism, and the two are totally opposed to each other, fundamentally. This is place-making alabaca. Barca was potentially, I'll repeat that later on, a revolutionary. He had fundamental criticisms to make, which he didn't spell out except in one place where he was challenging local rent-seeking elites. Yes, but the potential of Barca is to change the constitution of states. Well, from this point of view, I'm now revisiting EU cohesion policy. EU cohesion policy started out by supporting the least favored regions and supporting it from the center. And the European Commission was trying to establish relationships with those regions in particular, the potential beneficiaries of its policies. And from the beginning, there was a conflict here between who is going to be in control, the European Commission or the member states. And the whole story of cohesion policy is one of the conflict between the European Commission and the member states. Nowadays, cohesion policy, under the influence of ideas like smart specialization, is different. McCann, who has been a close advisor to Commissioner Johannes Hahn, says that it is dealing with a wide range of different issues and also operating at different spatial scales from very local and nationwide to cross-border spatial scales. And the European Commission, you will always find the European Commission trying to promote the cross-border spatial scales. Why? Because it's a counterweight to the nation states. So it's supporting Interreg, it's supporting the European groupings of territorial cooperation, it's supporting macro-regional strategies, everything that diffuses the power of the member states over their own territories. And this is a conflict. Perennial conflict between territoriality, with territoriality of the member states is what I noted there. Now I'm coming to the part about democracy. This is a major problem. It's a major constitutional problem, which I'm not qualified to really tackle because I come from planning, spatial planning. Yeah? But the point is, all elections are territorial. Our whole system of articulating the will of the people is territorial. So therefore, the interest of citizens, whether local, regional, national, comes first. The interest of other constituencies outside are not represented in the process, albeit not directly and very weakly indirectly. Now, there are discussions about alternative models. People are talking about polyarchy, and I'm here quoting from authors that I have studied, or about democratic experimentalism of how to change this whole process, but there is no definite conclusion. And each and every time that there's a conflict, of which there are many, of course, yes, between, for instance, the EU and the European Parliament on the one hand, and the member states on the other, the member states prevail. Why? Because they say they have democratic legitimacy. Yeah? And their own constituencies support them in this, yes? And as the more we get into a crisis situation, and not only because of the euro crisis, but crisis situation because of potential Brexit and because populist movements, actually populist movements in the various member states are an expression of this. Yeah? So somehow or other, we must move beyond territorial representation, but we don't know how. Yeah? We must somehow or other create a system, a democratic system, which reflects this idea of relativist constructivism. And I think this is the true Barker. Barker articulated this once again weakly. He is not a constitutional theorist either, but in challenging local rent-seeking elites, yeah? And at various other places. Yeah? Where does this leave states, and where does this leave Europe? Early on, if we had the proper presentation, I would have shown you Europe as a collection of member states, as this mosaic. I think we need to rethink this concept alongside with the concept of state. And I have two wild ideas in this respect, being a spatial planner. One is to visualize states, a collection of states like the EU, as an archipelago. An archipelago of islands. Yes, of course, there are states, there are islands, but they're embedded in the sea of relations. Maybe we can try the last slide. Yes, maybe we can see that. The very last, okay, I can do that myself, I think. This was Barker, yes. Okay. You see on the left, I think it's the archipelago of, around Stockholm, but never mind. The islands are the states, and they are embedded in the sea of relations. And the sea changes the coastline, which is what seas do, yes? And states have to cope with that. It doesn't do away with states, but it relativizes in the sense of relativist constructivism states. And this is a famous map in geography circles of Dees and Lord, yes? And it shows superimposed the various cooperation areas in Europe. And it reminds me of an archipelago. This is the second and last metaphor that I have for the EU. The EU is a cloud. These are, if you could see them, these are the various formations of the EU, of which there are many. There's first of all the Council of Europe enveloping the EU and the Russian Federation. Under the definition of the Council of Europe, Europe is a next-door neighbor of the United States, waving to Alaska across the Bering Strait. That's one configuration. Then there's, of course, the EU proper, but then there's the Schengen area, which is larger and smaller than the EU. There's the Eurozone, which is larger and which is smaller than the... Actually, it's also larger because Montenegro is using the euro. Yeah? And then there's the European Economic Area, and then there's Switzerland, which has 41 treaties with the EU. And then there's the Vatican, which is allowed to coin euro coins under a separate treaty. So the actual EU is a cloud, which I think is a fitting metaphor for the present day and age. Thank you very much. This is what I have to contribute to this, and I don't know exactly how it would impact smart specialization strategies, but I'm sure it has a message in there. I'm sure that you, as the people involved in implementing smart specialization strategies, are coming up against the territoriality of member states, of regions, and of municipalities. And you share the problems which also some spatial planners share when they are doing the actual work. They are in the same dilemma. They recognize spatial interaction crossing borders, but they are not able to adequately cope with it because they are up against territoriality. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we pass the word to Mike Hardy, who is at the Coventry University after traveling around the world, to make a long story short, as far as I could see, working with various bodies, including the United Nations, in the aim of intercultural dialogue and peace. The Cairo, Jordan, Azerbaijan, you name it, he's been there. And now he is working on concepts, if I understand it, of smart specialization in the question of social inclusion or inclusive innovation. But I'll let you take over and thank you. So it's a dimension we haven't seen yet on the table. So welcome to Mike, and thank you for coming here.
My pleasure, and I'm very, very grateful to the invitation and the opportunity to share a platform with such distinguished colleagues operating in quite a different area. So I wanted to start by being very clear that I come from a different place. I'm very much in favor of Dominique's presentation. Smart specialization is going to make a significant difference to communities and to places by being radical, by being embracing of change, and by helping local economies to grapple with what's a very difficult world. But my world is the more complicated because my interests are about people-to-people relations. They're in the interests of whether developing strength in the economics of a place benefits all those who belong in that place. So it's my interest is about inclusion that's quite different, not in being open to opportunity, but do we share evenly the benefits of change? And I was going to start by adding one sort of mistake to Dominique's list. Mistake number four. Mistake number four is that we assume we know the destination we want when we introduce policy for innovation, when we develop innovation policy, even as radical and as progressive as the current offer is. So I'm interested in whether or not we make the false assumption about the destination we're designing, a destination in which we see at an aggregate level the development of prosperity, of change, of modernity, but that in reality, we drive stronger divides between communities within that place. We live in a Europe of communities that are more unequal, that have greater disparity, that have less sharing of the benefits of economy at a time of significant austerity in public sector spending. So this is my interest, and this is where I come from. So my interest is finding, if you like, an S3 plus. Can we have an innovation policy that achieves all that Dominique and others have set out, but at the same time reflects on the social consequences for communities of the change? So that's my interest, and that's why it is such a privilege to be here, because the normal debates are contained within the drive for growth, the drive for prosperity. All I want to do is not resist that at all, but I want us to pause for my short little intervention to reflect on the consequences of that drive for sometimes divided communities. So I start at my university in Coventry, and as Jesse has pointed out, I lead a research center that's not focused on regional economic development. Originally, I was an economist. My early publications were on local economic development and local labor markets. But increasingly, they failed to explain to me what was happening in local communities that were becoming detached from modernity and finding the pace of change in modern times to be very difficult. If you look at my current university, Coventry, it sits in an area of the United Kingdom that many of you will associate with cars, with automobiles. It was the manufacturing and assembly place where cars were built. It always had, as a result, higher than average employment, higher than average wages. It was a relatively prosperous working class factory-based city in the middle of England. Today, in 2015, it may surprise you to know that there are more people employed in the automotive industry than at any time in its history. And yet we make very few cars. We have the global headquarters of Jaguar Land Rover, fortunately is doing very well, and we make London taxis. But the rest of car assembly and manufacture has moved. The changing shift in that industrial sector created huge challenges for the Coventry local place. Why is more people employed than ever before in the automotive industry is because of some of the smart specialization that's happened, not cajoled by the work of Dominique and others, but has happened anyway. The interface between high technology engineering faculties at the university and low carbon vehicle demands and the changing nature of demand for car industries at the high tech end. Coventry went up market in terms of its thinking and innovation. What happened as a result is the city fell behind the developments of technology, the developments of innovation. You now find the city became a magnet. It brought people in to bring with them the skills and the capacity to innovate that was needed. The university has grown. My university, 27,000 students. And when we did an ethnographic study, which my original interest as I'm now a social psychologist more than an economist, I asked questions of people in Coventry about how they related to this change. The university, who was working with the health services, with the automotive industry, with engineering, with high tech, with IT. And it won't surprise you that the majority of people in Coventry bore no relationship to this at all, were found it very detached, and had moved off into employment in retail, in coffee shops, into zero hours contracts and to relatively low hourly rates of pay. What had grown at the same time as public services, coping with the detachment of people, so we have more nurseries, more kindergartens, more hospitals, more care centers, and so forth. The public sector now unable to afford to continue to employ people in that way, so Coventry. I only give you that slight narrative, and I apologize, to tell you a little bit more about where I'm coming from. Now, my university charged my center to come up with a way of tackling what were very difficult social relations between the drive of innovation and actually the communities of Coventry, who felt quite detached. So this is my view that unless we think of how smart specialization as an innovation policy becomes more inclusive, looks over its shoulder now and then to make sure that people are keeping up, we will likely find greater disparity, greater inequality. And we are likely to find that large parts of the place that we're examining will be left behind. Now, what happens when they're left behind? Well, there's no problem, because we can mobilize the social policy academics and politicians. They can bring their social fund in. They can come and repair the damage that the innovation has created. This is no way to run a future place-based strategy, is my view. So the plus in my strategic, it's my smart specialization strategy, my plus is about not making assumptions that we're clear about the destinations until we develop an understanding of the destination. And by destination, I mean, where do we want the place to be in 5 or 10 years' time? Let's not assume that economic prosperity will lead to a trickle-down that drags everybody along, because the evidence in Europe of 2015 is that it doesn't not. And the evidence is that there is greater disparity and dislocation. Now, with my other hat, my real interest is the consequences of that dislocation for community tensions. Do you want a peaceful world or do you want a prosperous world? Shouldn't we want both? That's the easy bottom line. The slides aren't very good because of visuals, but I'm going to use them and I'll run through very quickly. We've heard a great deal about, and I wanted really to try and introduce to you a convergence between the sort of thoughts I've shared with you then and the very structure of thinking that develops within smart specialization. So the pursuit of a smart and sustainable and inclusive economy is what I'm interested in too. My definition of inclusion is slightly broader and maybe different. Oh, I'm doing the wrong one. I beg your pardon. I'm all right. I can see it. Yeah. So these sort of four bullet points won't surprise you, and they repeat what's already been said. I think they're very, very common in structure to the arguments that I form in my own view. I'd like to jump quickly to my conclusion in order to give you a better roadmap. I'm working on two projects. One is based upon the role of the university as a catalytic organization for the agenda I talked about, not just for innovation and working with smart specialization, and also an initiative we're doing in Coventry to try and catch up with the social relations aspect. So I hope that in the very end, we'll have time, you can ask me questions over coffee. We're trying to develop solutions, not just be critical of where we are. So the big question for me is the extent to which smart specialization successes are actually consistent with social cohesion. And it may be that if we're really successful with S3, we become more problematic in terms of the benefits within communities and the mismatch between the capacity to innovate and what's actually on the ground. It's also based on my view, looking at hearing some of the earlier conversations, that a growth in territorialism can itself be good for economic prosperity, but can indeed be at the expense of some of the issues, some of the equality issues I made. And people get left behind. And what can we do in order to mitigate against that? Improving connections was a very strong part of smart specialization. Improving connections between key players within the local place and between that place and other places seemed fundamental, and some of the examples that were highlighted by previous speakers emphasized that. But such change, as I've said, leaves people behind. The notion of an urban serving university is more commonplace in North America than in Europe. And this is a view that a university can view itself as an important player in a local economy, not detached, but integral, but not simply in terms of the contribution it makes to innovation in an industrial sense, or in a cluster sense, or in a cross-sector sense. So the three elements of being a strong player within the local community that is developed in the urban serving movement is a notion about neighborhood revitalization, as well as regional economic development, and as well as a focus, as has been mentioned, on the capacity to innovate locally and the capacity to participate in innovation locally. Let me stray just to give you one flavor of what we've done in Coventry. We found a demographic in the city of Coventry that had been totally left behind. All the changes that have taken place, not all of which are positive changes, but most of which are. Reflect on a city in which by 2020 will be a minority-only city, drawing huge numbers of migrants from all over the world, asylum seekers as well as economic migrants. It's a very diverse city. And amongst all that diversity, most attention was on ethnicity, on recent arrivals, on integration, on language. We found a demographic of 40-year-old women. 40-year-old women who'd been there for many, many decades. Four, of course. Had spent most of their lives after leaving work as carers of children, and had a 15-year window between the time that they would start to become carers of old people. Completely excluded community of real resource. Housewives who'd cared for children that now were going to care for old people, had a window in between. Some of the most resourceful labor market participants that you could have. Multitasking, they had experience of organizing, budgeting, and so forth, and completely left out. So it was an example of inclusive innovation, is finding a way of drawing 40-year-old women into the labor market in a productive way. And the university is in an ideal position to do that if it shed itself of some of its barriers and borders and bureaucratic requirements. Because of time, I'm going to flip on. And I'm quite happy to talk another time about some of the details. I wanted to flip to this slide because it probably summarizes where we're at and where I'm at with some of the research. We're not doing much work in other parts of Europe, but we are in North America, in Asia, in Japan, in Indonesia, and in the States. This chart in terms of inclusive innovation looks very familiar with some of the smart specialization literature. In the, you look at a place and you look at its assets. You look at the challenges it faces and you look at the potential that it has. But you don't do it from a prescription, however collaborative you want to be, of knowing where you're going to go. Knowing that the answer is in economic prosperity and in focused development. So the assets that we have in a place are as much the relationship between individual people as they are the relationship between incubators, between private sector, between engineering or computing faculties of universities. The assets are also multi-level governance, the extent to which my city is influenced by decisions taken in Brussels, in London, in the region, in the city, in the local ward. We have a local ward in my city with 120 first tongue languages that doesn't relate to a lot of the discussion that's coming from different levels of government. So multi-level governance is an asset that we'd look at more carefully. And social capital, the ability to look at the relationships that are informal as well as those that are formal are also important. In terms of the challenges, I come from a tradition of literature which looks at challenge of living together in diversity as being driven by faith, by differences of color, by origins, by ethnicities. But the interesting challenge we find is that the biggest challenge to our place is how used we are, how capable we are of dealing with the rapid change in a modern world. So what are we doing in our innovation policy to help people cope with the speed of change, as well as the nature and direction of change, which smart specialization helps a lot. How do we cope with the fact that tomorrow is going to be very different from yesterday, and that a large number of our people will find it very difficult to adapt? It's not that they're racist or that they're xenophobic, it's just that they cannot cope with the pace of change that innovation processes require for successful places. And in terms of potential, then much is similar to the work on smart specialization. How do we capture the potential of global alignment? How do we capture the analysis and knowledge base that we have in a diverse population? How do we exploit diaspora links? These are rarely mentioned, and yet in many of our European cities, diaspora links are characterized by remittance flows of funds back to home countries, but very rarely by the alternative direction of mutual benefit and transactions. Also, the potential is very much about how much risk you take. And the successful cities in my research are those that take risk. And they're organized, they're focused, but they're chances. They say that you can't prescribe the answer, let's just in colloquial English, suck it and see. The Coventry City University Initiative is a pilot in this regard. It's not funded by Europe, unfortunately, but it has significant funding from not-for-profits and from other foundations. and is developing the idea of inclusive innovation along the lines that I've described. Jesse, I'll finish there, and I apologize for running over.
No, perfect timing, thank you. Here I would throw the question to Dominique then. Is it an explicit intention of smart specialization to provoke institutional innovation? Jan is asking, can you build smart specialization with not so smart governments? Or is the intention to set into motion certain processes that give governments no choice but to open up or to shift approaches, and what Francesca was noting, this sort of desperate attempt to re-regulate, to regain control over a process that governments are losing control over, but also because of the way the world is evolving. But to what degree do you think this is was an explicit intention, or is it an intention of the Commission to open some cracks? Is that a fair question?
I think it's quite a sophisticated policy, and so it requires sophisticated government capabilities at any level. And of course, I mean, from the academia, I'm a professor, so we liked our idea. Then the implementation, as I said to Paola, in some points, you know, our idea has been lost in translation, actually. And I think this is the cost of having a big impact. This is the first time in my life that I got a so big impact in terms of one idea. And in a sense, it's like a lottery. There are many great ideas from economists who never being, you know, applied at all because it's too sophisticated or, you know, just... And we had some kind of, we were lucky, in a sense, because we were probably at the right moment where the Commission needs for some, exciting policy instruments, not only about austerity and so on. So there's something which tell the regional economies, okay, you have to, you can build, you know, you can take your future in hand again and build, you know, your past towards the knowledge economy. So I think this is a good idea and this was at the right time. Now it has been lost in translation. For sure, and this is the fifth mistake, maybe. So, which is first, we told the Commission, okay, you want to take smart specialization, you should at least try at the beginning with some pilot study. Try how regions will understand the idea, and of course, the Commission say, no, we have no time. You know, we have to implement it immediately. And of course, as it has been said, you know, there were a lot of misunderstanding. The second thing we said. It seems to us that this is a good concept for the less advanced region and the transition regions, but not for the top one, like, you know, Baden-Württemberg, Paris, or London. And the Commission said, no. I mean, it's too complicated. We want, you know, one instrument for everybody. So, and so on and so forth. So, I mean, which creates, at the end, a certain feeling of, yeah, I mean, this is no longer the idea I had in mind which has been implemented. With a lot of misunderstanding. When Jan talk of you know, this dilemma between specialization and diversification, precisely, I think it's wrong, because precisely smart specialization is about overcoming this dilemma. This is not about uniformizing. You know, when I was talking of fisheries in Galicia, the result should not be Galicia not only about fisheries. This would be totally wrong. So we don't have a dilemma between specialization and diversification. The idea is to get specialized at some point to transform the system, but the next year you will do different things. So this is this kind of evolutionary path that we wanted to have. And it has been very difficult to diffuse as an idea. So I think this is the kind of new generation of policy instruments requiring quite sophisticated regional capabilities. And I'm quite optimistic, actually, in many countries, not in all countries, but that's, of course, creates motivation in the regional capabilities and regional government administration. You have a new generation of policymakers who are excited to try to do that.
Comment from the floor. Could you please introduce yourself?
This one works. Thank you. My name is Alan Dyer. I'm from Northeastern University in Boston, Massachusetts. This is for the whole panel, I guess. I'm not sure if it's a question, a comment, or you may just decide it's my own misunderstanding, but from the United States sort of listening and trying to sort of synthesize at this early stage what everybody's been saying, I had this thought, and this is, I guess, what I'm sort of throwing out to you all to see if you would agree with it, that economic history is one of my interests, and it seemed to me that what I'm hearing in terms of smart specialization and then Professor Hardy's comment about the problems that even smart specialization could entail in terms of cohesion and social alienation, that it seems to me that maybe what I'm hearing is an attempt on the part of, let's say, Europeans or the EU or the Commission to define a new European model that instead of having economic development be a top-down process, that's what I sort of understand smart specialization as. It's a kind of the authorities at the EU saying, let's start it from the bottom up and see if that works better in a world where growth is now, if you can squeeze it, you get a little bit, but not like you used to get in the 60s. So growth itself will now become a bottom-up thing. That's the role of entrepreneurs, clusters, territory. But just as in the old model of top-down growth, Europe, certainly much sooner than the United States, realized it needed social welfare programs to also deal with people that are left behind. But those were also top-down. It was top-down social welfare. That what Professor Hardy's talking about and maybe just beginning to get a sense of is that if you're going to have this localized, decentralized, bottom-up growth, you're also going to have localized, decentralized, bottom-up social welfare, because it ain't going to come from governments that can't afford it anymore. Am I like really off in left field here? I guess this is actually right field since it's decentralization. Am I sensing that that might be what's going on, is that you're trying to change conceptually and then institutionally the whole notion of what growth is from a European context, but that's also going to entail a new, the top-down social welfare is not going to work anymore. Am I close?
Please.
So I think that's very perceptive, and that certainly you're jumping a few chapters ahead. We haven't quite read the introduction and we're still writing the preface, but let me suggest to you, I don't think this is a radical departure from top-down leadership of innovation. What I think it is the top saying, in order to be effective at top-down, we have to invoke a bottom-up alliance. We have to encourage more bottom-up lobbying and positioning. But it's top-down in the sense that the ultimate goal is to make the top spend more effectively. The ultimate goal of the European Union is to stop the emergence of disparity between territories. The European structural adjustment funding is about, the disparity between places. So let's not apologize for that. The European project has been amazingly successful with all its problems. But let's say that if we have now a more aware top that says, hang on, we have to actually radically change the way we listen to bottom up. That's very different from your concluding chapter, which I'd share, that we're actually going to decentralize. Because you're not. You're going to keep the resources, the resource framework at the top. You're just going to spend it in ways that encourage better practice. Now, just moving on to social policy. What a world are we creating where the very processes that lead to prosperity are generating a greater demand for social welfare, for safety nets, for protective strategies. So my question is that we don't need to go there. We need to include that in our design from an early stage. And I'm very sympathetic to Dominique's challenge. The policymakers don't listen to all the nuances within our thinking because it's not convenient. And they have a pressure as well. I've been there on the other side as well. It's a very difficult place to be, formulating policy in a time-bound period with a budget restraint, with electorates watching everything you do. It's a difficult position. But essentially, we have to be more radical still than the radical approach that we've got. And we must incorporate the social consequences of our choices alongside the economic results of our choices. So let's measure smart set specialization by the success we can get by Galicia's fishing and by the automotive in low carbon in the Midlands in the UK. But let's not forget the social consequences of our actions. This is a very good point.
Dominique?
Yeah, just it seems to me that the idea of bottom-up is just a consequence of the fact that this is a policy about to have to make choice. You know, if you want to implement a policy like in many countries in Europe as a R&D tax credit, which is quite successful, you don't need to be bottom-up, you know, you have to decide that, and that's done. Here, because you want to make choice, because you cannot do everything, you cannot help any activities, if it is top-down, it is a catastrophe, and the French are doing that all the time, you know, Colbertisme industriel, you know, you will do that. And this is not the way we think it should be. So it's just a consequence, a logical consequence of the fact that you have to make choice, and so the choices have to reflect really the grassroots, the bottom-up, etc. And then what I wanted to say to you as an American is that I think what we do is a response of problems which are similar to everywhere, including in the US. You know, when I talked about this PhD program in many states, the students are educated here and they go elsewhere. This is the Midwest syndrome, so Paula Stefan, it is clear that our response is smart specialization in the sense, okay, we have a few micro systems of innovation so that the people who are educated here, they will find a good job here. So, and also, I mean, I remind this book by Susan Berger, Making in America, where she said, we have so many SMEs. If you forget about Silicon Valley and Boston, you know, so many SMEs, she said, which are home alone. Which means that they are now missing all the complementary capabilities they need for innovation because all the systems are dislocated for issues like large companies, outsourcing, offshoring, etc. And again, smart specialization means building this ecosystem so that the SMEs can be really empowered with all the complementarity capabilities we need. So, I mean, this is a certain kind of response to general problems in any industrial economies, development economies, that we try, actually. Yeah.
There was also, no one has mentioned it yet explicitly, the introduction of social innovation, sort of after the smart specialization process got started. The DG Reggio published the guide to social innovation, which is how I got involved in all of this mess, in 2013, I think, 2012, relatively recently, and then began to ask regions to incorporate social innovation into their smart specialization policies, which some did, as Mike was saying, say, we'll make growth over here and take care of the excluded over there. But some were trying to integrate it, and they're with the logic that in the territory, on the ground, at the bottom is where the two things actually meet. You can analyze them from the top in a different way, and you can create different top-down. But when you get on the ground, inevitably they either collide or work together. Was this part of the original thinking? I don't know if you've seen these guides to social innovation. I mean, it's a real policy thing which indicates to regions where to fit it in, how to use the different funds, and there was an attempt, I don't know where it came from or how successful it's been, to try and build a social dimension into the heart of the policy. I don't know how successful that has been.
The social innovation, I mean, the smart specialization, this is a growth policy in a sense, you know? This is really innovation to support and to animate growth, economic growth. To what extent social innovation is part of the picture? Actually, I don't know. Who has a definition of social innovation here? What is a social innovation? Do we know that? Is a computer a social innovation?
The commission has a definition, of course.
Is a computer a social innovation? If yes, of course, this is part of the picture.
Yes.
So I don't know, actually. I have no idea. The problem with the commission here, social innovation is a nice word. They want to flag it, but I'm not sure. And maybe Mike is better than I to, maybe certainly is better than I to tell us what is a social innovation. I'm very interested. Then I can tell.
I'm not, don't ever use the word certainly. But, so
probably.
I think social innovation was a very necessary in 2013, in 2012-13, it came along to reinforce the other things that were happening. And what it did was similar to what had happened in the corporate sector, in my view. The corporate sector woke up when the Harvard Business Review published some work about responsibility, about saying that we could have a world in which the private sector creates value and then shares it. The Rockefeller exploits the world, makes his millions, but then he's a philanthropist. That's the old model of not being very social in what you do. And the challenge to the corporate sector in the early noughties, around 2000, 2006, that period, was why don't we create shared value? Let's not create it individually and share it, let's create it together. So you have a much more responsible focus on decision making in corporates. I think the public sector caught up. It takes 10 years later, you know, it wakes up and it says, maybe we can introduce the notion of social innovation. So what is it? I think social innovation is changing the way we relate to each other, changing the way we communicate, changing the way we make decisions, changing the way we travel, changing the structure of commuting as part of local labor markets. I can go on. In other words, it's some of the glue that informs and reinforces the way in which place territories work. So in Coventry, let me take a tangible example. We suddenly found that the major asset that Coventry had was not its people, was not investment, was not the prettiness of its countryside, but was how quickly you could travel to London. This is a very different way of thinking. If suddenly you mobilize an asset that says you have proximity to somewhere, then you're no longer frightened of your PhD students going to London. Because actually you can begin to argue that they can stay here and work in London. Or they can work in London, or they can work in Coventry and live in London. So there's all sorts of changes. That's what social innovation is. Changing the way that the social issues interact with the economic and political issues.
I like this definition, but to be logical, it should not be part of the discussion of smart specialization. Because it should not be, I mean, smart specialization is about choices between fisheries, biotech, and mechanical engineering in the footwear industry. You have not to choose between fisheries and social innovation. I mean, social innovation should be done in any way, in any case. So, I mean, and the fact to say that it should not be part of the smart specialization is not to be offending. Smart specialization is just a strategy to think about where, you know, we should innovate in terms of technology, etc. That there are many things beyond that. And social innovation, probably. So this is a mistake of the commission, I suppose.
But there's, you're next in line.
I wanted to come back to something that Professor Foray is saying. If I understood your response to my original question, it's that it's not a different model of growth, but it's more recalibrating how choices are made. Is that accurate, fair? To recalibrate. how choices. You use the word choice a lot.
Come spendi.
And so one way to think about this is a recalibration of how choices are being made in Europe. And it was in the back of my mind, and I didn't want to say it because I'm an economist, but and I've regretted that decision many times in my life, but you do what you do. That's what an economist would say, is that you're describing a situation without using the word that an economist would immediately leap to, which is that you want to create a real market system in Europe. Because if you say decentralized choices, economists can build you any number of models to show that the best way to decentralize decision making is to create a market for something. But do you really want to go that far? Yes, a market system for everything. So maybe we'll get into this afternoon on our panel, but it's one thing to say conceptually this would be a better way to cause innovation or create entrepreneurs, discover them, whatever. But as we say in the United States, probably everywhere else, the devil is in the details. So how are you going to do? I was looking at the World Bank report on doing business before I came to the conference, and they rank countries, 189 countries. Italy's number 56, by the way. You were 52 in 2014, you're 56 now, I'm sorry. It includes things like getting credit, starting a new business, registering property, getting construction permits. I mean, that's what I mean, the devil's in the details. An economist would tell you that you need to put markets in place for all these things, even if it's locally based or locally oriented, to get the resources, the human resources together, to get the knowledge resources together, to get the construction permits together, to get the financing together. Because otherwise, I don't think smart specialization, I think it's a great idea, but I don't see how it happens unless those things are taken into account. What worries me is that when you get into that level of detail, you're forgetting something that Professor Hardy said you forget, which is why are we doing this in the first place? And for me, that's economic growth. And for me, if you take economic growth and you wed it to markets, you can forget social innovation. Because and it's okay to say it doesn't belong in this conference, but I think it probably does. Because if you're going to scrap the old method of growth, you're going to also have to scrap the old method of social welfare. I'm just thinking.
We have not to go into the details of all the legislation, but smart specialization was specifically, you know, addressing some targets for the structural funds, not covering everything at all. So that this was maybe, Paola knows that better than I. So this is only three thematic areas. So R&D, I don't remember, but I mean, then there are many other kind of way of spending and having projects for very different things. So we should not give too smart precision too much actually of power in and influence. This was really for helping regions to spend this money for R&D, innovation, these kind of things.
Can I add something? Okay, does it work?
Yeah.
Okay. At the beginning of his presentation, when he was presenting the idea of the smart specialization strategy, he said, okay, in Europe, for a long time, growth policy has been horizontal. All the stuff you were talking about, like, you know, build well-functioning credit market, well-functioning public administration, environment for firms, horizontal policy in R&D, education. This is part of the core message that is still there. But what happened? Especially in lagging behind areas, not necessarily this effort, which is very horizontal, and it's at the core of the European message, gave these territories sufficient tools to grow and to compete. In fact, most of the horizontal investment, if you practice horizontality in a lagging behind territory, you lose resources. at a certain stage. So you invest in, you know, so smart specialization adds up to this environment. It's not a substitute. So of course, I mean, the creating of the market is there.
Sorry, there was a point from down the table. Yes. Can I make a comment first about going back to social innovation and the definition? Social innovation is also an extension of the open innovation model, which is very industrial. It's a fact that you don't necessarily do research in closed laboratories. You do research by engaging end users, final beneficiaries, and so on and so forth. And that is a process that began with the Living Lab movement about 10 years ago, and now has gone outside even of the industrial sphere. So the if you're looking at value chains and not just bank accounts, then the community dimension as part of the research laboratory can become, and there it is very much a question of social, of smart specialization, because the quality of your community to be creative and to generate innovations depends on framework conditions, as you mentioned, the ability to get credit or whatever. Startups don't just come out of, intuitive ideas, but it also depends on the territorial qualities, the culture of the people, and the social needs. And social innovation, in that sense, is very much about market creation. Market creation is what I think Dominique was talking about when talking about all of the question of related variety and so on. And to the degree that, as the discussion of the Calabrian smart specialization strategy, that at least in Europe, and thank God it's that way, social services are a market. And that is a market which needs to be developed and created and improved. And there is a market for offering health services to people. That's an enormous market. It's a big market, and it happens to be one of the markets where the engagement of end users and the co-design approach is proving most successful in ambient assisted living and all of the specific sectors that are related there. So social innovation has the different phases, which do seem to coincide. Sorry, Dominique.
It's just to answer to really your excellent comments. I should read, I should read your documents, etc. But it seems to me that, all these problems, aging society, rural areas, as you said, neglected diseases, etc. Of course, I mean, this is very good goals. And if your strategy is about responding to these kind of things, like supporting rural areas through development of ICT, etc., and if you build capabilities to do that, I mean, this is really fine. This should be part. I have looked at a couple of regions which have more or less the same kind of structure, spatial structures as yours, where you have clearly in the smart specialization strategy a priority which is developing ICT to support rural areas. I don't know whether this is social innovation or business innovation, or we don't care actually. But this is a good specialization actually. The only thing I would say, you have to prove that what you will do is really based on a couple of capabilities you have here. So that means you have labs, you have people, you have things that can really form a kind of a cluster to address this problem. Because as I said, it's also possible to solve everything by outsourcing, outsourcing a nice consulting company from everywhere who will pretend to solve all your problems, but this is not what we have in mind. We have in mind to build this ecosystem. But I'm fine with all these innovative solutions to these kind of social problems.
Please.
Yeah. So I'm Professor Eric Bishard from Salford University. So we're one of the partners, obviously, on the MAPS-led project, but I also teach on the international PhD program, which I'll come back to in a minute. I just want to make a point, quick point, because I think we could be here for a very long time arguing back and forth, between the importance of social economy and the importance of economic economy in terms of this subject. And I would just want to support Mike Hardy, because I think he's a bit lonely up there, and to tell you a quick story. The first is that we, Mike and I and others, are not going to win an argument against unreconstructed market-led economists. And we have many in our group, and that's their world, you know? That's the way it is. So we're just not going to win this argument. It's our job, Mike and mine and other people, to exemplify the monetization of social gain so that we can prove and speak in the same language to our unfortunate friends who don't get it yet, that actually you cannot do this work without a total and complete understanding of the sustainable development in any one direction. So a very quick story. I was commissioned by the Royal Institute for Chartered Surveyors. Some of you might know England. This is a specialist group of people who spend their entire life putting a monetary value on things for the built environment. We make a joke about them that they understand the cost of everything and the value of nothing. There we go. Yes, well, it perfectly describes these people. Yeah. So, amazingly, these people commissioned me to do a study on how we put a monetary value on social and environmental change. Okay? I produced this report for them. They looked at it and said, "We can't publish this. This is not about market economics. It's all about non-market economics. This, our rule book says that this is impossible. You can only understand the world through market-led economic thinking." And they reluctantly agreed to publish it, which will come out soon. But it just goes to show that we have a very, very long way to lead our friends and colleagues into the enlightened world of proper sustainable development. And can I finish by saying that the students, the PhD students, did a fantastic piece of work over the last week, and I've brought it up to this room. We'll set it up in the break, and I really encourage, I think in this area we'll put it on the stand there. I really encourage everybody who's interested in this work to show that this can work out. It's very clear and has direct economic implications. If you ignore the social and environmental value of what we do, we are always going to fail. Thank you.
We give Mike the closing shot on that, and then you were asking for the floor, right? And then we have lunch, right? We're a little over time. But
it's always good to have allies in the room, but I wasn't feeling too lonely. But I wanted to just make a final comment about why social innovation is mainstream and should be part of this. It's not outside somewhere because it's different. And I didn't interpret your view that markets were more preferable, but there was an inevitability of that line of thinking. I think social innovation has become increasingly important part of capacity to innovate in local places. I see the capacity to innovate as a fundamental in this whole discussion. And social innovation, in my view, contributes directly. Let me give you some examples. The raising of finance for small business has been revolutionized by social innovation, by microfinancing. The ability to avoid the market rates of interest for high-risk loans by going to credit unions. The ability to mobilize 50-plus out-of-work steel workers or car manufacturers by preferring them as employees for bus drivers. The ability to keep old people in the community rather than to ship them off by market-driven forces into old people's homes. There's a list as long as your arm of social innovations in recent years which lead directly to a more conducive space for innovation. So if that's the case, and I think it's easy to argue, then there's a direct economic benefit to for innovation policy of social innovation, if it's chosen correctly. So we didn't get the minimum wage in Britain because of market forces. We didn't get the campaign for rent controls because of market forces. We didn't get social housing as a requirement as a percentage of new development of housing because of market forces. We got it eventually because the very powers of market forces recognize the economic contribution that would make. So there's such a close-knit And it's a missing part, I think, of the overall innovation story.
Beautiful. Lunchtime. Thank you. Thanks to the brilliant panel.